Today we are going to talk about Internet of Things. And as you can see right from the title slide, the things consist of several things which already happen actually. Television is already interneted. Air conditioners, refrigerators, projectors, many of these things. Alright? So we will talk about what are the things and why IoT is important. What is new in IoT? Basically, what are the new networking protocols? In particular, there is 1901 and 1905. Those two protocols we will discuss today. Then, there are other protocols that we will discuss in the next few classes, are MQTT, 6LoWPAN, RPL, etc., etc. A big part of Internet of Things is what they call machine-to-machine. Now, this is not the whole thing, but big part of Internet of Things is machine-to-machine. And machine-to-machine means that basically, generally, most of the communication is between people. It starts from a person and goes to a person. Email, text, chatting, video, everything like that, right? But there are certain things that start from the machine and end on the machine, never go to a person. Sensors, temperature controllers, things like that. And so those are machine-to-machine. And since there are so many more machines than people, every person has so many machines on them, around them, that obviously the number of machine-to-machine nodes and machine-to-machine communication is going to be much, much higher than people-to-people. And here is a list of numbers of things like 1.1 billion smartphones and smart meters. So you all know what is a smart meter. Basically, a smart meter is something that is, first of all, internet connected. So you might have an electric meter at home or in an apartment, which nobody comes to read it. How is it read? It is read remotely by the internet. Second thing is, if it is smarter than that, first is interconnected. Second thing is, if it is smarter than that, then it might even say that the price of the electricity is low right now, please go ahead and start whatever you want to do, something that requires a lot of electricity. Or it might say that please don't use that right now because the load is too high on the system, so keep your load down. You know, you will save some money. So those are the smart meters. E-readers and tablets, obviously you know. Networked office devices, we know all of those things, and million medical devices. So now, more and more medical things, things that we wear inside the body, such as heart monitors and things like that, they would be interneted. Right now they are not. Right now, the maximum in basically they might talk to your phone, which is actually a good starting point. Once they talk to your phone, then they talk to the internet anyway. So they will be interneted, and then anybody remotely can monitor. Automobiles, they are not, but they will soon. And appliances such as fridge and all that. Military devices, obviously. Information technology devices. Supervisory control and data acquisition, SCADA. Now that's a word that we use in IoT a lot. So basically, supervisory control and data acquisition is for the industrial control systems. So when you have an industrial control system such as, you know, car factory, there you will have some things that are monitoring as to what is the weight, what is the time, what is the width, this and that, and then something else will be controlling those things. So that is called SCADA and data acquisition. And then other non-phone, non-tablet, non-reader electronic devices. So there are lots of other things. So that tells you that, you know, basically the number of people is only 5 billion or 6 billion and it will not change very much in the next few years. But the number of devices is going to change and change fast, right? More and more. So now Cisco's number is actually, sometimes they say only 0.6% of the devices are connected. Now, maximum you can say 1%. So 99% of the things are not connected today. So there is 100 times growth potential in the number of devices that will be connected to the internet. And that includes your refrigerator, your car, your washing machine, your heater, air conditioner, garage door. Actually, many of these are already connected. For example, your heater, you can buy now, you know, your thermostat. And for car, you know, you can buy a lot of stuff. So from 10 billion today to 50 billion in 2020, that's a projection. And that will include processes, data, things, and people. $14 trillion over 10 years. Now, this is coming from Cisco, actually. $14 trillion business over 10 years. Now, this is not all going to Cisco. Otherwise, Cisco will be a trillion-dollar company. This is the whole thing which people who are using it, these machine-to-machine communications, such as GE or any other company that is in manufacturing, or hospitals which have, you know, medical devices. So, this is a $14 trillion industry for connecting these things to the internet. Now, there are other names for this. For example, Cisco calls it Internet of Everything. So, they have changed from IoT to IoE. And the reason, the basic differentiation they are making is that IoT does not include people. But we are not going to go away. So if you can include the Internet of People and Internet of Things, it is Internet of Everything. Right? A smarter planet. IBM calls it a smarter planet, where everything is smart, and smart means connected and, you know, being able to control remote, being able to be controlled remotely. Industrial Internet by GE, and Cyber Physical Systems by NSF. So these are all the different names for the same thing. One thing I forgot to tell you is that Gartner made a list of top 10 strategic technologies. Top 10. The list is here. I have the URL here. You will see that third number is Internet of Things. And before those two are mobile devices and mobile apps, which are already happening. So, I mean, those are not surprising. So, now IoT. So, basically, I went around and looking for what is happening for IoT, and I was surprised to find that a lot is happening there. So, there is a group called NITRD, Networking and Information Technology Research and Development. This is a group of 15 federal agencies that give money for research. NSF, NIH, NASA, DOE, DARPA, ONR, you name it, they are there. And what they do is every year they have to make a budget for the next year. So they recommend what should be the budget be for research for the next year. So NITRD is the one where it starts, and then they give it to the president. And president generally implements it, and then because this is all research, I think there's not much politics on that one. But anyway, if you read the NITRD document, which you can find on the reference here, for 2014, for example, they have year by year, every year they recommend something. So you can go and see what they have recommended for the next year. CPS is one of the recommended areas since 2012. So a lot of money has been going into CPS. Another area that you might recognize is big data. So a lot of money is going into big data. The government research funding is going into big data. A lot of research funding is going to CPS. And some of the words that came from that report are here. What they want to do is models, tools, and architectures for highly dependable CPS. Now, here's one thing I found in that document, and this is important, is that the document is maybe 60% security oriented. So any area they will list, and then they will start talking about security for that area. That's the biggest concern, it looks like to me, to the government. And so they talk about software development, and they will talk about secure software development. Similarly, CPS, first thing is highly dependable CPS, you know, and that is where availability and security comes in. Safety models and designs for CP medical systems, cloud enablement of CPS, software verification and validation of large-scale CPS, for example, next-generation air transportation. So basically, cyber physical systems means that something where there is a physical system, such as a bridge or an airplane or whatever, and there is a cyber system, which is computing and networking. So, actually, it is right here on this slide. CPS is the tight coupling between computing and the physical components. That means a smart infrastructure. Now, that includes industrial control systems. So, industrial control systems, if you have a factory, it's all CPS. So, you will have SCADA again. Just as supervisory control and data acquisition, you will have distributed control systems within one location. You will have, so this basically is SCADA is generally a large area. It could be spread over a large area, right? Thousands of kilometers. Where if you have in a small building or something, then it is called DCS. Building would be like a power plant or a water plant or a water treatment plant. And then if it is even smaller than that, and that is called PLC, which is basically a device, programmable logical controllers. So all of these things are, you know, kind of hierarchically make up this industrial control systems. Cyber actually includes both computing and internet working. I mean, in my view, cyber should be simply internet, right? But the way I have seen it used in that report and in general outside, you know, our community, cyber includes computing and networking. So tight coupling between computing and networking and the physical components. So another thing that needs, now here's the thing, all of this can be called CPS, or Internet of Things actually, is electric grid. So the all the electrical transformers, meters, everything that is in the electrical grid, water supply, water, wastewater treatment, chemicals which are used either for medicines or for agriculture, transportation such as bridges, cars, aircrafts, healthcare, robotic assistance for the elderly, teleoperational, so on and so forth, and then including buildings. All of these can be part of CPS. Now, by the way, this whole list came from that NITRD. So it was interesting to see that their money is going to be divided. Now, the way it happens is that they might get about $4-5 billion, actually $4 billion is probably on the small side, but they get so many $1 billion, they give it to those 15 departments of the government, and then each department then gives it out according to the plan here. So if you go to this report, it tells you how much for what, you know, they are recommending. All right, so a smart grid, $4 billion funding came in Economic Recovery Act, I think that was in 2008 or so. Smart grid got $4 billion. So now with that money, they can identify surges, outages, and failure points. So when there is suddenly a demand surge and causing into electrical surge, anything goes out, they can figure it out. Can contain the damage and reroute the power around the failure while sitting at home and sitting at a central point. So I mean, like, if previously, before smart grid, people had to go there and, you know, do all this, but now they can remotely say, okay, all right, now don't send any power there, send it this way. So, you know, the failures can be isolated. Can accommodate new off-grid energy sources. So what is off-grid energy sources? If you have a solar system in your home, you are off-grid energy source, right? If you have a one of those fan kind of things that you see on the highway, those are off-grid energy sources. Those are not energy sources that are coming from the grid. Load balance dynamically. And then basically, when you use power, it comes from many different sources, and they have to decide where it comes from, because everybody has a different rate, and they have to buy it. Utility companies have to buy electricity too, and so they have to decide where to buy it from. So they have to do that. Be less vulnerable to accidental or malicious harm. And then second thing is, obviously, like just like the people are kind of trying to target websites, they're also targeting physical systems. All right, and that is actually of a big worry, because I mean, if somebody targeted a nuclear plant or targeted a water plant or targeted, you know, any electrical plant, that can cause a lot of damage and a lot of people's death. So meters that provide features needed for energy control. So this is part of smart grid. Efficient cryptographic communication between substations and control centers. So now comes the security part. All of this has to be secure. All of this has to be, you know, basically access controlled, encrypted, and so on. And so because of that, they also have developed some protocols for publishing and subscribing of system data. So who can get the data and who can get the data, and how do you make sure that the data is real? So there is a workshop, again, in which only these 15 departments participated. So there is a report which talks about, you know, all this work.
With all these different devices going on the internet, you mentioned security. So is there a particular task force that, you know, helps you decide if your heart monitor has been hacked or your toaster has a virus? Like, who's in charge of these devices?
Yeah, right. That's a good question. Basically, so right now you've never heard of a toaster having a virus, right? But tomorrow you will hear. The ones that they get connected, then all those things that are happening on your website will happen to your toaster. And suddenly your fridge will go down or go up, suddenly comes up, you know. So those are the things that people are working on. And those are the research problems kind of things, you know, where how can you do a very lightweight things? If nothing else, it will alert you. Now, in the last 1 week, My credit cards have been hacked 3 times last 1 week. Okay, so what saves me is the alert system. So I have put so many alerts that anytime anything changes, I write up, you know, something is wrong. A simple message came to me saying your password has been changed. Now I didn't change my password. Somebody did. I immediately went to the website, found out that somebody hacked and they transferred $7,000, blah, blah, blah. I called the bank. Everything is taken care of. So that's what saves it. You know, so you have to have that kind of alert and things like that. So recent protocols for IoT. So this is all, you know, if you read the books on IoT, they will go on talking about how good IoT is, what you can use it for, and that's what we have done so far. But we are networking guys. So let's go back to networking and see what we can do for IoT. A lot of it has already been done. And here are some of the protocols that are new in the sense that, like, we define every time, last 3 years, last 4 years. So power line communication is not last 4 years, but the latest version of it, which we'll talk about. IPv6 over low power, routing protocols over low power, ZigBee, HCM2M, and MQ telemetry. These are all things which happened in the last 5 years. So we'll talk about them in this course. There are things that didn't happen in the last 5 years that we will not talk about in this course are these protocols. So these are the protocols: BACnet, LANworks, Modbus, KNX, ZigBee, Z-Wave, MBus. These are currently used in different segments. For example, BACnet is used in the housing segment. If you have any controller in any buildings, like for example, we have, you know, in the campus, some controllers that control different buildings, heating systems and all that, that would be BACnet today. But we are not going to talk about that in this course. Similarly, this rest of this list. Okay? But there is a lot already. All of this is going to be slowly, over a period of time, going to be replaced by what is coming. So we are going to talk about that. Okay?